And I just wanted to say that, too, that the form of the book presented itself easily in the sense I just put the essays in chronological order. But then the result of that became very interesting because it was the course of his own life. Because one essay will be very theoretical. And then the next thing will be a speech that he gave in Brazil. And then really theoretical again. And then, you know, a Mike Check speech at Occupy Wall Street. And then really it's weaving back and forth constantly between intense reflection on very, you know, abstract concepts and then engagement. And that's reflected by his influences. So,
but it's empowering to know that, I guess it does really require like more, almost a more spiritual understanding of like that we are in this together as a whole world, not just a certain class of people or a certain group of people that have a certain function in society that they will be the leaders. I just really appreciate that. And like, I think people are really getting to that point.
Awesome.
When I see like other movements and stuff.
Thank you. So Joel said, one of the quotes I remember is that the religious right is the worst of the right, and the religious left is the best of the left. And I think that sort of speaks to both the tremendous power, also the ambiguity of spirituality. You know, it's this tremendous, powerful thing, but it's not necessarily going to be your friend if it's in the, you know. So I think that's something I wanted to mention. Another thing I wanted to mention, a lot of really great readers in the room tonight, there's this book, The Radical Spirit, collects his essays on psychoanalysis, and the last section of the book is all on this subject of spirituality, and there's really far-reaching, sort of mind-blowing essays that I had never seen before, and we never discussed, and just read earlier this year on this theme if you want to go deeper into it. The other thing I want to mention is that I met Joel in a group called Scientific Soul Sessions through Fred Ho. I got the tie from Fred Ho. We should mention that. That's part of the lineage as well. And the whole idea of Scientific Soul Session was that there's scientific socialism we've been talking about since Engels, you know, we got to be scientific about things, but then you got to be soulful about things as well. But then too often you have the soul session with no science, and you know, you can get all feel good, but you got to get things done too. So that's part of it. I also want to mention about Marx, something Joel always really educated me on and drove the point home on, is the real Marx, who is like astonishingly unknown, especially to Marxists. He was there's so much in his life that is not really talked about by the people who sort of claim his name. Especially in this country. You know, he spent the early part of his life as an economist, but the whole end of his life he was really more into anthropology. He took copious notes learning work on the Iroquois, learning the Iroquois phrases. There's even a quote which was suppressed under Stalin for years that, you know, maybe the Algonquin native could be closer to socialism than the bank clerk in Ireland. I forget exactly what, don't quote me on this, but something along those lines. He was really thinking this stuff through. Another thing we connected through in this group, Scientific Soul Sessions, was against this idea of manifest destiny Marxism. You know, that the industrial proletariat and the revolution is part of the great advancing civilization of the West. And how, you know, it's surprising how deep this goes, and it's still around today. And this idea that, you know, if you read the documents about the First International, they were just convinced that the industrial working class was genetically programmed almost to take us beyond capital. It turns out that didn't work out that way. As Syed said, in Russia and China, that's sort of where things really took off. But, you know, as you mentioned, sir, I'm really glad it's not like we're going to dismiss the industrial working class either. Those that's a crucial role in those revolutions. And I guess I would just say that it's open today. The search is open for the revolutionary subjects. I think we have the theory, but we don't have that kind of level of conviction and commitment and faith that in who the revolutionary subject is. It's kind of everybody these days. But I think we have to do more work to focus on that, to have a little more clarity about where to direct our efforts and our organizing. And I'll just conclude by saying I'm living in Asia these days, in Sri Lanka, and a quarter of the world's industrial working class, a quarter of the world's proletariat, and also a quarter of the world's original peoples, Adivasi, forest-dwelling peoples, are in Asia. And I think that the future is in that kind of humanity is going to be tipped in that region. And I think that this theory is going to be a crucial way to take us forward.
one thing on that, I didn't know about the quarter-quarter thing, but right now, the largest industrial strike ever to take place on the planet is taking place in India against the Modi government.
Yeah. Thank you.
And it's overwhelmingly industrial workers for precisely the reason you laid out. So it's a complicated business trying to transform the whole world. I mean, really, you need to do a lot of good thinking. You need to do a lot of stuff. It's not enough to think about it. And much as I love what Joel did, it's not enough to write about it alone either.
Sure, yeah.
Our job is to figure out how to move in that direction, organize, you know, both today and prefiguratively. It's a complicated business. I've been trying to do it most of my life, and I can't say I got to figure it out. But that's why I just love Joel, because he was also trying to grind this thing out all the time. God bless him.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming.